Well, welcome again, viewers, trusty fans, and crazy insect people. Today, I'm going to attempt to make my first Patreon-inspired video. Yes, it's been a while, it's taken a while to produce it, because my first goal was 1 hour long video, which is quite a challenge for a very broad subject such as Lepidoptera in general. Of course, I can talk about it for hours, so that's no problem. But really, I had to mentally prepare a little bit and think about the things I'd like to cover in 1 hour. My Patreon has taken off, and I did have moderate success, so I'd like to thank all of those who supported me. And for those who don't, I'd advise you to check it out, because I still have a lot of goals left, and still many videos coming. And I was going to make a 1 hour long video about Lepidoptera in general, their ecology, what makes them interesting, what makes them different, what are their special traits. Well, if you look at Lepidoptera, let's start with the basics. Lepidoptera is an order of insects, and what sets them really apart is the fact that they have scales, right? Lepidoptera, if you dissect the word, it's comprised of both the word pteron, which means wing, and lepis, which means scale. So Lepidoptera is a combination of lepis and pteron, which means basically Lepidoptera means scale wing. Which isn't strange, because the scales on the wings of butterflies and moths are one of their unique traits. Well, at least there are other insects that have scales. I believe, for example, silverfish, I don't know if that's the correct English name for them. They have sort of scales on their body, but there are no other insects that have scaled wings the way Lepidoptera do. So that really sets them apart. And they share a common ancestor with Trichoptera. I have to think about Trichoptera. I think the English name for them is the stoneflies. And many million years ago, the stoneflies. Whoops! I gotta set my camera straight here. The stoneflies. They diverged from moths in an evolutionary way, and. Basically, that's how Lepidoptera came to be. So, if I want to talk about their general lifestyle and ecology, you have to consider the fact that Lepidoptera in general, if you look at their ecology, they are, of course, most of the time they are plant feeders, herbivores. And what's interesting is Lepidoptera are often, they evolved together. It's kind of a co-evolution with plants. Many butterflies and moths have their own preferred host plants, and they'd rather starve than try to feed on a plant that's unfamiliar to them. So that's also one of the traits of Lepidoptera, is that they are specialists, right? There are hardly any Lepidoptera that are generalists, because all of them have adapted to a few families of plants, or even a single species of plant. Of which is survival is dependent on that particular species of plant. So that's one interesting trait to remember, because that means basically the success of one species is very restricted to their habitat and the availability of their own host plants. So it's hard to pick a certain point where to begin, because Lepidoptera in general, man, it's such a broad, such a big topic, you know, and I just wanted to cover the entire basics in one video. So I think what I'll do is, first I'll just explain the different life stages they have, because one of the things that does set them apart is the fact that they have a holometabolism. And holometabolism is a fancy word for having a complete metamorphosis, because you can insects, you can divide them in species that have a hemimetabolism, I believe, and holometabolism. And hemimetabolous insects are ones that have nymphs, for example, praying mantis or grasshoppers. If you compare the young instars with the adults, you'll see that the young instars resemble the adult, and the only difference is the adult has wings, right? And that's a hemimetabolism, aka an incomplete metamorphosis. And holometabolic insects, for example flies, Diptera, or beetles, Coleoptera, but also Lepidoptera, aka butterflies and moths, have a complete metamorphosis. That means that they have larval stages that are completely different from the adults, right? That's certainly one of their unique traits, and it's an advantage as well, because you know, insects that have larval stages, they don't compete for the same food sources as their young. You can imagine that a young caterpillar which feeds on plants, it doesn't compete for food with an adult butterfly, which has extremely different lifestyle and different threats, different predators, but feeds on nectar as well instead of you know, host plant. And it allows them to have one separate life stage for reproduction and one separate life stage for feeding and development, which is also part of their success. So I think what the first thing I'll do is talk about the adults. The imago is the scientific name of the adult. So we have an adult butterfly or moth. And if we analyze this creature, you'll see it consists of you know, the basic parts that many insects have. For example, they have one thorax, one abdomen, one head, they have antenna, they have four wings like most insects. And one of their unique things in their morphology are their mouth parts, because Lepidoptera have a proboscis. So basically their proboscis is the scientific name for their tongue, you know. They have a tube-like mouth part they use to suck up fluids. And adult butterflies and moths usually can only intake food in liquid form. That means nectar or juices from rotten fruit. And so they drink through a straw-like mouth part. Actually, what's interesting, if you look at their proboscis, for example, you use a microscope and you magnify the proboscis, you'll see that it actually consists of two separate parts. And in the middle of them, those two separate parts are connected by a zipper-like mechanism. That sounds interesting, but it's true. They have these little teeth, and it just fits together, and it interlocks the two separate parts of the proboscis into into one thing. It functions as a wall while it consists of two parts. And maybe if you have seen a butterfly emerge, you've seen that when it emerges, the proboscis is divided in two parts. And what it does after emerging is it uncurls them and it adds them together. And when they stick together, it doesn't come loose again, and it functions as one proboscis. And what's interesting, their feeding habits is also what limits their lifespan, as adults at least, because you can imagine that, take a look at their diet, for example. It's very simple. They're only able to intake fluids. So one of the things in nature, fluids they can feed on, are nectar or fruit juice from fructivorous butterflies that seek out rotting fruits on the forest floor, you know. And if you look at what nectar or fruit juice consists of, basically it's like energy drink, right? It's just water with sugar, fructose, right? I was going to say sucrose, but that's not true. I think most sugar in nectar and fruit will be fructose. Basically, fructose or nectar or fruit juice, you know, it's just sugary water. Sugar is a great, great fuel, you know. It's It allows them to be very energetic, but it has one giant flaw, one big problem in their biology, is that basically sugar, it doesn't have any building blocks in it. It doesn't have nutrients. It has no nutritional value. Basically, by only drinking fluid with sugar in it, they aren't able to form any new cells. They aren't able to regenerate their own tissues. That means that most butterflies have a very limited lifespan of about 1 or 2 months. Of course, there are exceptions. I'll get into that later. But the reason most butterflies only live for a very short time is because they lack the nutrition they need to live for a long time. And that's a strange truth, you know. So just the fact that they are limited to nectar, they are limited to fruit juice or tree sap. Try drinking energy drinks exclusively as your diet. For example, if you drink energy drinks every day and don't feed on anything else, I'm sure you'll die pretty fast as well. And that's the same problem for butterflies. They can't regenerate tissues, they can't form new cells, they have no building blocks, no amino acids, no proteins in their diet, nothing. So that limits their lifespan to only a few weeks, usually. But what's interesting, there are butterflies that have overcome this problem. And for example, the passion flower butterflies, right, or passion vine butterflies from the genus Heliconius. Their proboscis, it secretes one enzyme, a digestive enzyme. And this enzyme is able to digest pollen and make it, liquid, which allows them to suck up the digested liquid pollen. And this pollen from flowers, you know, that often sticks to their tongue, they digest it and drink it, and that allows them to feed on, to intake the proteins they need. And the result of this adaptation is that Heliconius butterflies can live for 8 to 9 months in captivity, which is extremely old for a Lepidopteran, at least for the adult phase. That's extremely old, just because they have this adaptation, you know. And unlike any butterfly or moth, they are able to digest pollen. Anyway, well, you'll also notice that there are a few families of very, very primitive butterflies and moths. Actually, they're only moths. There are no butterflies that have this, that still have jaws. They are called archaic moths, for example. Genus Micropteryx, it's a Microlepidoptera. It still has jaws, it can chew, but it's extremely rare, and there are about 215,000 species of Lepidoptera, and only one handful of discovered species still has jaws, and they are remnant species, aka very, very ancient species that survived the passage of time and didn't have to adapt. Like that fish, for example, that ancient fish, the shellacanth. Yeah, it's a unique kind of thing, but generally speaking, the mouth parts of Lepidopterans are unique. Also interesting is that the majority of Lepidoptera have no mouth at all. That means they cannot eat. This is true for the majority of moths, not butterflies. But the moths, yeah, I know, that's a difficult sound for me to make because I'm Dutch. Trouwens, als je me nooit nog Nederlands hebt horen praten, dit is hoe ik praat in het Nederlands. Ja, dit was gewoon een excuus om Nederlands te praten. That's how I sound in Dutch. I think you just had to hear how I sound normally when I'm not trying to force myself to speak another language. Anyway, the majority of moths doesn't have any mouth at all, which means they can't feed, and this explains their extremely limited lifespan as adults, right? Basically, they can't feed, so they are forced to starve. For example, my specialism is silk moths, Saturnidae, And the adults only live for 1 or 2 weeks maximum, and then they die because they run out of energy and they are unable to replenish their energy by feeding, which is quite sad but normal for many insects, not only moths but beetles, flies. Many of them can't feed as adults. So yeah, basically for them it's only a very short reproductive stage that allows them to be mobile, you know, it gives them mobility, the ability to fly and quickly locate each other by smell or pheromone, quickly pair, lay eggs and die, while they spend the majority of their life as larvae or cocoons, not as adults. So and also about food intake in Lepidopterans, besides butterflies, besides sugar, they often also drink minerals and salts, which is why butterflies are also seen drinking water from streams or mineral deposits or even feces or dead animals. That's because to produce sperm, the males need some kind of amino acids and minerals. And it's usually the males for that reason that flock to food sources that carry salt, for example urine. For example, if you have to pee very badly in the jungle and you piss somewhere on the ground, you'll notice it attract a ton of butterflies, and that's because they are attracted to the salts. And you'll notice that only males are attracted to this because they need the salts, you know. And adult Lepidoptera, usually, if you look at their survival techniques, they don't have any kind of defense mechanism, at least not offensive, though they have a lot of defensive strategies, like scare tactics. You'll notice that many butterflies have eye spots on their wings. Yeah, this is very effective in scaring away birds. A fair share of them is also toxic. You know, there's not many butterflies or moths that are so dangerous that that if you eat them you'll die. But yeah, if you're a bird or if you're a cat, yeah, if you eat some kind of moths or butterflies, you can get pretty sick. For example, tiger moths, they have very bitter tasting chemicals, but also toxins in them. For example, the garden tiger moth, Arctiacaia. It's a very common species, but birds know how to avoid it, which is why it has bright colors, because it has toxins. That's also one of their defensive strategies. Of course, a very popular one is camouflage. They rely on not being seen at all. So basically that explains why many butterflies have on the underside of their wings, they are brown, and when they close their wings behind their back, they look like a dead leaf or anything similar. Another thing they can use is use bright colors to scare away predators, and so they avoid eating them. And of course there are other things like playing dead, or you know, I've seen it all. Basically the other survival strategies they have, it's mimicry. Some butterflies look like moths or wasps, or they mimic spiders. There's even a moth that mimics a spider. Many of them mimic wasps, by the way. I think wasps look very similar to you know, their general body shape to Lepidopteran, so this allows them to mimic wasps easily. Also, wasp mimicry doesn't only trick birds, it also tricks wasps into not attacking them. Wasps are a very popular enemy of Lepidopterans in all life stages. So, and the adult biology of Lepidoptera, basically it only revolves about reproduction, about, you know, pairing, having sex as efficiently as possible and producing offspring. And their entire imaginal stage is focused on reproduction, which is quite logical if you think about it. So yeah. And well, I think that covers most of the adult ecology and morphology. Alright, so let's try that again, folks, because I just found out that my camera has a 20-minute record limit and it just cut me off when it reached the record of the limit of 20 minutes. That means I'll have to divide this in fragments of 20 minutes each, but that's no problem. One of my problems is I have to make this video 1 hour long, and that's not difficult because it's hard for me to talk for 1 hour. No, it's difficult for me to stop at 1 hour, because if I wanted to, I could talk about this for 10 hours. I have to keep it short, you know, and that's difficult for me because I have so many things on the top of my head that I could tell you. And it's just, I mean, I'm really obsessed about this subject. I mean, I could go on for hours and hours and hours. Either way, I just covered what sets Lepidopterans apart from other insects, right? We went over the proboscis, which is quite unique. They have unique mouth parts, the scales. Now, there's something about the subject of scales. I wanted to talk about this subject in detail, but my other Patreon goal is making a video that covers the subject of scales and their function and my morphology in Lepidoptera. So I don't want to cover this subject of scales right now, because I'm going to make a much more elaborate separate video about this subject very soon. So yeah, but the scales is one of the things that sets them apart. Holometabolism sets them apart, a complete metamorphosis. Of course, this is not unique to butterflies and moths, but it still sets them apart. It's one of their characteristics. Everybody knows the caterpillar, the cocoon, the adult. It's one of their lifestyle traits. So I briefly covered adult biology, their feeding habits, a little bit of their morphology, mostly based on their mouth parts, and then because I'm trying to cover the things that are unique to Lepidoptera. Of course, I could tell you about their legs, I could tell you about their antenna, I could tell you about everything, but then the video would be too long. So I'm just trying to cover the things that make them really unique among insects. So let's get to the pupal phase, because I just talked about adults briefly. Well, 20 minutes, that's not briefly, because for me that's very briefly, because I have so much information in my head. It's one giant chaos, and I really want to tell you everything at the same time, which is impossible. Anyway, the pupal phase is also quite interesting, because this is where the metamorphosis takes place into the adult. It's a very important stage for their survival. Also because butterflies and moths spend a lot of time in their pupal phase, and it is critical for this pupa to emerge at the right time. For example, a lot of species spend the winter as a pupa, which means that these pupa have to be able to sense when the right time to emerge is. For example, in Europe, where I live, that would be spring, right? Because when it's winter, it will be cold, and if the adult emerges too early in winter, it will freeze to death. There will be no flowers, no nectar for it to feed on. It will have no host plants in winter, no chance for it to pair, and it will die. So pupa are very sensitive to their environment, but not also due to overwintering. But you can imagine in Africa it can be very, very dry, and during the dry season there's no host plants available. It's too hot, which means if they emerge during the dry season, they would stand no chance, you know. There would be no food, no anything. They would probably burn or desiccate in the unforgiving scorching sun. So these pupa in Africa or Madagascar, they can detect a high level of humidity. Basically, when the rainy season is coming, and when the rains come, it means the plants will grow, everything will turn green, and that's when the moths will emerge in very large numbers. And pupa, they are they are very delicate. They can detect a lot of things. They can detect temperature. They can also detect day length, though diapause that is induced by day length is often induced in a caterpillar, not the pupa. But okay, that's very technical. Pupa are also often covered by a protective layer called the cocoon. This is only the case with moths, right? The cocoon is also interesting because You know, we know silk. Silk is a very important product to humans. We use it in many things. But for moths, silk is also interesting because silk is very strong, you know. It has very unique properties. It's a very strong protein. And what's interesting, when a moth emerges, it burns a hole in its own cocoon by secreting an enzyme called serapeptase. And it's like stomach acid, you could compare it to that, because, it's digestive juices actually, not stomach acid, but digestive enzymes. What's interesting, serapeptase is an enzyme that only dissolves silk. That means it doesn't dissolve anything else, but only silk. It probably attacks very specific proteins in the silk. Anyway, many people think the moths, they scratch a hole in the cocoon, but that's not true. They actually burn a hole in them by secreting digestive fluids from their mouth parts. And what's interesting about pupa is the fact that the metamorphosis takes place inside their pupa. And it's also a very unique process, you know, because what happens inside a pupa is the remains of the caterpillar, they turn into goo. The whole insides, most of the intestines of the caterpillar, they just turn into one primordial soup. Basically, it's the body dissolves, right? At least most of it, because some parts of the brain will remain intact. That means, yes, adult moths and butterflies can remember things they learned as caterpillars, because one part of their brain remains intact. Of course, they are insects, which are pretty mindless creatures, but they can learn things. For example, there were researchers that were researching hawk moths, and they gave the caterpillars an electric shock when they smelled a certain smell. So the scientists basically, the scientists had a strong smelling chemical, and every time the caterpillars would smell this chemical, they would get an electric shock. And when the larvae were reared, and when the larvae became moths, these moths would avoid the same smell. That's strange, because the moths had no negative experience with this smell, but the caterpillars did, because they associated it with an electric shock. That means the adult retains information from the caterpillar stage. And that's that illustrates the fact that parts of the brain remain intact, but really nothing else. And what happens inside the pupa is stem cells, they start to divide and form a completely new body from the remains of the caterpillar. So that's something very interesting to think about, because for me it's unthinkable that for any organism to just, you know, to develop a completely new body that's so extremely different, you know. It's really a miracle of evolution. Insect, that's one of the reasons I love insects so much, because they defy logic, you know. They seem almost magical to me. So, of course, these pupae also have to be very resilient to cold, to warm temperatures. Of course, many, even in Siberia, you have moths and butterflies which have to survive very, very harsh winters, and where most of the pupae are protected by a silk encasing. Many of them decide also to burrow and pupate underground, where they are protected by an underground case. And there are many strategies for pupating. Of course, butterflies often have a naked pupa or chrysalis. But yeah, all of it, it's very, very diverse, right? And often butterflies have camouflaged and pretty pupa because they are more exposed to the environment. They pupate just freely on host plants or in the vegetation, while butterflies and moths tend to burrow or make a protective case. Well, a butterfly just landed on the camera. It's kind of sad that you wasn't able to see it. But I was distracted by a butterfly that really just landed on the camera. I wish I could capture it. Oh wow, I'm caught off guard. Anyway. So I just covered the emergence of the adults from the pupa, the fact how it's dissolves its own silk encasing. The fact that, you know, pupa are immobile, they are very vulnerable. It's a very vulnerable life stage, but also very important for the butterflies and moths. And I think they spend most of their time inside their pupa for most species, because some tropical species develop very, very fast. And that's basically one of the things that does set them apart. Let's think, is there anything else I could tell you about pupa? I think we covered the basics here. Maybe we should get to the stage of caterpillars, which is also quite interesting. The caterpillar stage for the Lepidopterans is the developmental stage, right? Basically, the caterpillar stage or the larval stage is the part of their life cycle they only spend feeding, you know, feeding in the vegetation usually. Lepidopterans are usually almost exclusively vegetarian or herbivorous, and often very specialized on certain host plants. In fact, I think I mentioned this before, but butterflies and moths have a very strong co-evolution with plants, and some caterpillars are extremely adapted to feed on only one or two kinds of plant only and nothing else. For example, cabbage white butterflies will only feed on cabbage or plants related to cabbage, because they are programmed to recognize the phytochemicals, which means basically the chemicals in the plant that have the characteristics of cabbage. For example, for cabbage or mustard, this would be mustard glycosides, right? This is what they recognize, and they would rather starve than try to eat a plant they are unfamiliar with. And there are almost no species that are generalists, though some can be very polyphagous. For example, tiger moths, tiger moth caterpillars. Some species will eat literally almost anything, including lettuce from the supermarket, fruits and vegetables, almost all kinds of low-growing herbs and weeds. But they're still herbivorous and still have a restricted diet, which restricts them to a certain habitat or, that sort of thing. So if you look at caterpillars, you'll see they're often also very well camouflaged, and their shape and their digestive system is perfectly adapted to their host plant, to their respective host plant. For example, some species specialize in feeding on very toxic plants, you know, and their evolution is, and their digestive system is perfect for digesting and neutralizing the toxins in their host plants. And what some larvae even do is, when they feed on toxic plants, is they sequester the venom. I'm calling it venom, but plants don't have venom. Well, some do, but I'm talking about poison here. For example, the monarch butterfly, which feeds on milkweed, Asclepias corvassica, or any other kinds of Asclepias. Milkweed is pretty toxic, right? So, caterpillars or insects in general, they don't really have a liver to neutralize toxins with. Actually, insects have fat tissue, and they use this fat tissue as some sort of liver, because what they do is they store the toxins that they absorb from their diet, they store it in their fatty tissue, which means their fatty tissue sequesters these venoms, it collects them, it's a sort of bioaccumulation, but often it's on purpose. For example, the monarch butterfly is impalatable or unedible to birds and many predators because it's toxic, but it doesn't produce this toxin itself. It just steals this toxin directly from the host plant and it recycles it. So it basically means it eats a poisonous plant and it doesn't digest the poison or neutralize it. It stores the poison in its own body. And when the adult butterfly emerges, it's still poisonous if a predator eats it, which is one of the advantages of feeding on, inedible plants or toxic plants, really. Also gives them some degree of protection. And that's one of caterpillars are often very specialized in chemical warfare. For example, maybe you know Hemiluciné, like Autumeris. There's plenty of caterpillars armed with very sharp or stinging toxic spines, but also urticating hairs or Lasiocampidae are also very bad in this regard. They're often covered with very razor sharp tiny hairs. You should check my YouTube channel and see some of my videos about Gonometa nisa or Autumeris, or man, some can be really horrible. But yeah, they really have to apply these kind of strategies, because caterpillars are very slow, they are very immobile, and when they are discovered by a predator, they are pretty much sitting ducks. So they have to rely on either avoid being seen by camouflage or hiding themselves, or they have to deter the predator by chemical warfare or scaring it off in some other way. Many caterpillars have defensive chemicals. Some can even spray formic acid at their enemies, for example the pus moth Cerura finula, or there's many things. For example, Papilio caterpillars, they have this organ on their head, the osmaterium, which can expel disgusting smell. For example, often it contains butyric acid, which it deters birds but also parasites and wasps and other predators. It's one of their most fascinating life stages, and also one of their most vulnerable. I think caterpillars generally have a very high mortality. They are subject to many kind of diseases and parasites and predators. Of some species, only 2% of the caterpillars even make it to an adult butterfly or moth. You should think about that percentage. 2% is almost nothing. And that's also the reason they lay so many eggs, you know, because basically they have just strength in numbers. It doesn't matter if many of them die, there are so many of them. If a few survive, it will be okay, and they can produce many more eggs, really. That's their survival strategy as well. So as a whole, if you look at their ecology, you'll see that because of this life stage, they are very, very restricted just to certain habitats and host plants only. Because the butterflies and moths, they are specialists. They specialize on certain plants, they specialize in certain habitats and ecology, and whatever. It's just one of their traits is they are very sensitive to the environment. And that's why habitat destruction is one of the biggest threats to butterflies and moths. It's, pesticides, but also deforestation, or anything that changes the layout of their habitat or the flora and fauna. They are very dependent on the plants. So yeah, that's one of the main things of caterpillar ecology, really. The 20-minute limit's almost up, so I'm gonna cut this clip and divide it into another fragment. Mwah! See you in a few minutes. Caterpillars, for the most part, and most of their traits. And let's see, what shall we cover next? I'm just trying to cover all the little bits that make these creatures stand out, and it's very difficult to fit all of this in one video, man. I think in the future I'm going to make more detailed videos with more detailed illustrations and examples. But yeah, this is just my first attempt, right? One of the things about caterpillars is one of the massive threats they face in the wild are predation. I mean, a massive part of them gets eaten by predators, but also parasites. For example, parasitic flies, Tachinidae, or parasitic wasps, Ichneumonidae, are a massive threat to caterpillars. And there are many species of parasites who focus on one single species of butterfly or moth, which is amazing. That means they have co-evolved, actually. So one of the other survival strategies of caterpillars can be being social or having a gregarious lifestyle. Gregarious is the fancy word for having a semi-social lifestyle, like Autumeris, like processionary caterpillars, or many Lasiocampidae. And basically they communicate via chemicals, of course. Caterpillars have very weak eyesight, but they have a very strong sense of chemoreception, aka what you would like to call smell. Their sense of smell, of course, it's very powerful. They can detect their own host plant, but they can also detect, the signaling chemicals their social bodies use to congregate into congregations. Just these huddled together groups of caterpillars, which can feed together, pupate together, even shed skin together, and show a lot of behaviors. The majority of caterpillars, however, seem to be living a quite solitary lifestyle. And if you look at their morphology, what's interesting is they have true legs and prolegs, and their prolegs are little suction cups on the end of their body. And these prolegs, these suction cups, they aren't true legs, really. Like any other insects, caterpillars only have six legs. This applies for almost all insects, really. They all have six legs, including caterpillars. And the prolegs are just modified part of their body, not actually true insect legs, divided into typical, femur, tibia, tarsus, the traditional insect parts. And of course, caterpillars also have an abdomen, thorax, and head, but it's harder to see because it's fused together in one larviform body. But if you look quite a little bit, if you study their morphology, then you notice they have a thorax as well, which has different properties. Some caterpillars can even make sounds to deter predators by gnashing their jaws together, or forcing air through their spiracles, which makes them squeak. You should look up Rodinia fugax. They squeak like ducks, rubber ducks, It's very interesting, all of it. And their only purpose is to feed. Of course, many moths don't have mouth parts and a very limited lifespan, which means these moths live off the food reserve they built up as caterpillar. So the purpose of the caterpillar is to get as fat as possible in a short amount of time and really produce a fit adult that has a nice and large food reserve in their body, enough for them to survive for 1 or 2 weeks. That's one of their main traits. And I think I've covered. Yeah, pupation is also interesting because, pupation, the pupa, when a caterpillar pupates, actually it sheds its skin. The pupa is basically one modified instar in the insect lifestyle. And it sheds its skin, and below it is already a new cuticle, which hardens into a pupa. So, I think there's not much left I can tell you about caterpillars. That basically covers it. What's interesting is with moth butterflies and moths, we know the adults but not the caterpillars. And this is true for many tropical species are collected at light and put into collections and then identified at species level. But what's interesting of the majority of these tropical species, their caterpillars are unknown. So this is part of the scientific work I do, is recording the life cycles by breeding these tropical moths. And their life cycles are usually just completely unknown. And that's my field of work, to record their faunistics, record their life cycle, and publish this information. I have only one publication so far, but I have many coming up behind the scenes, and you'll see it soon, just trust me. There's a lot coming up this year. Of course, then we have the eggs. The egg stage, really, it's not that interesting, because that's very comparable to the egg stage of many or other organisms and insects in particular. Of course, oviposition, butterflies are very picky in where they lay their eggs. Of course, they seek out certain host plants, and sometimes they taste the vitality of the plant. If it's healthy, if it has fungus, if it's in a sheltered spot or in correct sunlight, and then lay a few eggs and move on to the next plant. Moths are usually not so picky and just dump their eggs everywhere randomly. One fun fact about eggs, though, is eggs are fertilized upon laying them. When a butterfly or moth lays an egg, the moment it passes through the abdomen. It passes an organ called the bursa copulatrix, or sorry, I pronounced that one wrong. It's the, I believe it's, yes, it's the bursa. Man, I have to look that one up. But I believe it's the, it's either way, it's an organ that stores the male sperm. I'll try to look it up. Bursa copulat. I'm cheating on my phone now. I'm trying to look up the correct name because I want to give you the correct information. Ah, I was right. Forget what I said. I was completely right. It is called the bursa copulatrix, which is a difficult word for me to pronounce. So I got confused there. Basically, it's a sac inside of the female's body that stores the sperm of the male. And it's interesting, if she mates with multiple partners, which some species can do, it will store the sperm of multiple males. And the egg will pass through it, and random sperm cells will fertilize it, which means they are basically Darwinistic bingo balls of random offspring, you know? Each egg will can have a different father if the female has mated multiple times. But some species only mate one time and immediately lay their eggs. So just so you know, inside the female's abdomen, the eggs are never fertile, really. They're only fertilized when she actively lays them. That also means that if you find a dead butterfly or moth, cutting it open and removing the eggs from the abdomen will have really no positive effect because they aren't laid. The female needs to lay them to actively fertilize the eggs. And there are also many species that overwinter as eggs. Of course, many agar moths, they overwinter as eggs, or Notodontidae, or Limantridae. Sometimes eggs are protected by abdominal hairs, which the moths or scales that they rub upon their the egg package, which protects them from predators, really, and they often have irritating or toxic hairs on them. So that covers the egg stage. I think I went over the general biology of Lepidoptera. Maybe we can get into some fun facts I know from the top of my head, maybe. Man, it's starting to get a little bit difficult now to tell you things that are completely new and that aren't random and are out of place. Maybe if you'll notice that, of course, population ecology of butterflies and moths, it's about huge numbers, you know. You should know that it's literally is bird food. They are consumed by the millions of them at the same time, which is why they lay so many eggs, and which is why it isn't really a problem if you catch or kill a few butterflies for the purpose of scientific collection or whatever. I promote collectors. I think it's very important for people to have an insect collection because science is based on that. And oh yeah, let's talk about their genitalia, because the genitals of butterflies and moths are also quite important and determine what species it is. The definition of a species is when one kind of organism is unable to pair with another organism and produce fertile or offspring. And what's interesting is the genitals of butterflies and moths, they look like a puzzle a little bit, you know. It has the males often have two hooks that open, while the female has a kind of sac and a chitinous protuberance, and the male just it grabs the female these hard parts, these chitinous parts with the hooks, and it interlocks like a puzzle. But for example, take the cryptic wood white and the normal wood white, Lepidoptera sinensis, I believe. Oh no, Synapsis, not sinensis, and I have to look up the scientific name very quickly because I want to pronounce it right. It's a problem, people, that I don't really know these names from the top of my head. But luckily I have them at my fingertips here. It's not often that I have to look up names, but talking for 1 hour long really has exhausted me a little bit. It's Lepidoptera sinensis. And Lepidoptera sinensis, the wood white, is distinguished by the Lepidoptera. What's the species called? You know, screw that. Let's take another example. because I'm talking about butterflies here, and it's easier for me to use moths as an example. But take the pine hawk moth and the Iberian pine hawk moth, for example. Sphinx pinastri and Sphinx maurorum. And in appearance, these two species look very, very similar. And the only difference between them generally is their genitals. You have to dissect them to see if there's a difference between Sphinx pinastri and Sphinx maurorum. But these genitals are very important, and they don't fit together like a puzzle, which means the two species are unable to mate with each other and pair with each other and produce offspring. And the same thing for the wood white and the cryptic wood white, but the same thing is for thousands and thousands of tropical butterflies and moth species. And some species are based purely on the shape of their genitals. And some scientists go even farther and exclusively describe them based on differences in their DNA, which is something I quite disagree with, by the way. It's not okay. I don't think you can define a species by DNA, but sure, there are people who do it. Point is, their genitals are important and very complicated, and they are formed like a puzzle which fits together, and some populations have different genitals that don't fit together, which means they are technically different species because they have different populations who are unable to pair and mate with each other. That was basically the point. Let's not get too difficult this time. And if we talk a little bit about their senses and organs, of course butterflies and moths also have antennae, which are pretty important, and they serve as chemoreceptors. Butterflies can also taste with their legs. Some have modified legs, for example Nymphalidae, brush-footed butterflies, have a modified pair of front legs, or aka brush foots, they use to smell and taste. But for example, Papilios also have taste receptors on their legs, but mainly they also use their antenna to receive each other's pheromones and detect their own host plants. And yeah, these antennae, they do play a pretty important role. For example, Saturnidae moths have a feather-like plumate antenna, and these antennae are so sensitive they can detect one single molecule of pheromone in the air, which is extremely insensitive. These insects are just so extremely complicated and fascinating. And the color patterns are really interesting as well, because butterflies have actually hidden color patterns on them in ultraviolet, in you know, not only ultraviolet, but you know, some also use, for example, light reflection, even light polarization. Some butterfly wings, actually, when they reflect the light, like shiny iridescent blue morpho butterflies, not only do they reflect the light of their wings, they also polarize the light. And some butterflies are able to see the difference between polarized and non-polarized light, which allows them to pick up on each other's color patterns and recognize each other as partners. So yeah, all of this is really groundbreaking. And yeah, I think I went over the most of the life cycle, the morphology, and yeah, that's pretty much it. Maybe we'll talk about some interesting exceptions. For example, I said most of the butterflies and moths are herbivorous, but there are very few carnivorous caterpillars. For example, in Hawaii, there is one family of moths that have caterpillars that evolved to be carnivores. But also, there's also one moth, and in the Netherlands we call it the hyena, yeah, literally the hyena. I don't know what it's called in English. It's a Noctuidae species, and usually it feeds on trees like oak, but when it finds another caterpillar, it will grab it and kill it and eat it. There are also some Lycaenidae, some blue butterflies, or at least from the family of blue butterflies, and their caterpillars don't eat plants. But the caterpillars eat aphids or lice, really, from plants. It means they're technically carnivorous, like ladybugs. But some also infiltrate the nests of ants and eat the ant workers and ant larvae. And that's very interesting, because they infiltrate the nest and confuse the ants with pheromones. And the ants treat them like their own, really. They even feed the larvae. And the larvae are just consuming parts of their own nests. So that was just the general coverage of the life cycle and evolution of butterflies and moths. And I think that was it for now. If you stay tuned, I'll produce more content pretty soon. Of course, I've reached my Patreon goals, which means that, of course, I'll be making more content pretty soon. I still have many videos to make, including one that covers the subject of scales on Lepidoptera. But yeah, I just talked for 1 hour straight. And let's see if there's other interesting things I can tell you. Maybe you guys would like to comment on this video and just tell me a few subjects you'd like to know more about, you know, so I can talk about them. I'm open to suggestions. And yeah, if there's anything you're curious about, just tell me and I'll reveal the information to you, because I know a lot, even if I say so myself. Thanks for watching. This was my first Patreon video, and stay tuned, because I have a lot of goals to fulfill yet.